Thanks so much for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Julie Philipp. It's that time again. WXXI and its Voice of the Voter partners are once again launching Vote Up New York, a multimedia project to help keep you informed about the upcoming elections. With just 3 months to go before Election Day, the key campaigns and issues are starting to take shape. I've invited WXXI's 1370 Connection host Bob Smith in to start the discussion. Thanks for coming in today, Bob.
Our pleasure.
Now, you know, it is only 3 months away, but things have been really quiet so far compared to some election years.
I think one reason, of course, is the presidential election at the top of the ticket is not considered to be competitive within the state of New York. There are other states where everybody's concentrating their fire. New York is pretty much written off into the blue column, as well as a lot of the industrial states in the Northeast as well, though not quite all.
We typically are, but, you know, the first time Obama ran, there was a lot of excitement and buzz, and it's just really quiet.
Understandable, because I think a lot of people had elevated expectations about what would happen in the next couple of years. And as we're finding out, the economy had been mired in a lot deeper, thicker bog than we realized, and recovery has been a lot more painful. And even some of the signs we're getting right now are paradoxical. I mean, on the one hand, the Rochester metropolitan area is a net job creator. There are more people working than ever before, a net of nearly 10,000 new jobs over the last 12 months. That's good. But the unemployment rate is a little higher than it was a month or two ago because there are more people going out and searching for the jobs that are being advertised now. The labor market's crowded. It's definitely a buyer's market if you're looking for employees. So that's frustrating. The unemployment rate isn't coming down anywhere near as fast as people hope.
So the economy is still going to be a very big issue in the upcoming election season. Let's start out by just sort of walking through. There's a great number of races going on this year, even though so far it's been relatively quiet. A lot of candidates out there.
You watch especially the congressional battles. There are some districts that are, well, kind of tough to predict in a way. You look to the east of us in the Syracuse district that's now represented by Anne-Marie Burkle, which impinges a little bit of the Rochester area, though it no longer has any Monroe County towns within it. That one's going to be close again, especially because Anne-Marie Burkle lost some of the areas in eastern Monroe County that literally provided her margin of victory.
Because of the Republican
Enrollment advantage in that area. Mm-hmm. Well, she doesn't have that to deal with anymore. It's tighter still. Dan Maffei believes he can take that district back again. It's anybody's guess whether he will or what the numbers are. We haven't heard any polling yet. But that's one certainly to watch. Another one even closer to home, the Monroe County, and now all Monroe County district, that's the big battle between Louise Slaughter, the incumbent, and Monroe County Executive Maggie Brooks.
And really, you might think that's the only race going on right now in Monroe County.
That's all you hear, although they're not advertising either. They're out and about a lot and getting a lot of free media coverage because it seems like they're everywhere. And it's understandable because they're so well-known and so familiar. Both women are quite well-liked, and they have a lot of cross-party appeal, which makes this race interesting and close. And it's anybody's guess as to whether or not the nominal plurality in registrations that Louise's party enjoys will come through, or whether they'll split their vote and make things really interesting. Don't expect a landslide either way. Mm-hmm. But nobody knows yet because we haven't heard any polling taken. And maybe the Voice of the Voter poll, which will be coming up this fall, might be the first real indication of how the two candidates are going.
We will certainly find out something about it, I think. And then moving a little bit to the west of us, there are a couple of other congressional races.
The one interesting one is, will Kathy Hochul hold on to the district that she captured a year and a half ago? That used to be a safe Republican district. That, of course, we know that Chris Lee kind of crashed and burned because of some personal embarrassment.
We don't need to go into that, but yes,
we don't need to detail. Everybody remembers that well. There's another Chris running against Kathy, Chris Collins, who is a very well-financed Republican challenger, but he is a man who carries a lot of personal baggage of a different kind, and that is he's very controversial, not exactly well-liked, lost his re-election bid for Erie County Executive in 2011, and burned a lot of bridges at that time politically. We'll see if he can repair those and actually take that district back, or whether Kathy Hochul has been working awfully hard, been very visible in the district all along, whether that will enable her to hold on.
Okay, and just really briefly, let's run through the non-congressional races. There's quite a list of those as well.
The state Senate is interesting. interesting because you've got two districts which were competitive in 2010, although in both cases the Republican incumbents won. Joe Robach is trying once again. We're not hearing much about that race yet, either side, but they'll probably put some ads on the air pretty soon and try to defeat each other. Then Jim Alesi is leaving the stage. Mm-hmm. He had some controversy, personal controversy involving that lawsuit, that litigation, yeah. Which
again,
I think everybody remembers.
There, so yeah.
So, but also I think his vote in favor of same-sex marriage, which although generally popular with voters in the area who more often than not agree with it, was not popular within his party. And that became clear that he was going to have a fierce challenge both in the primaries and from a possible conservative challenger if he tried to run for another mm-hmm. term. So he opted out. Now it's an open seat, basically. It's going to be interesting mm-hmm. to see how that turns out and which way it goes. The parties have been competitive. Will they be competitive this time? Who knows?
Up. There's some county races, city races. There's quite a list of no shortage of candidates to choose from this year. Now, let's touch on, you talked about the ads that are going to be coming out fairly soon, and there's some interesting things going on in the broadcast industry that are going to make this an unusual season when it comes to political advertising.
On the one hand, you have a whole flood of special interest groups that are going to take advantage of the Citizens United case to pool special interest contributions, many of which can remain anonymous, so they don't have to put their fingerprints or don't have to attach their names to some of what's said in behalf of their favorite candidates, as long as they at least nominally don't coordinate what they're doing with the campaigns they're trying to help. Now, whether that's happening under the table, who knows? Who's going to prove it? But the bottom line is, as long as they can credibly say that they're independent in their expenditures, they can do whatever they want to and spend as much as they want. Mm-hmm. But here's a wrinkle that a lot of people hadn't thought about. Candidates who buy time for themselves, maybe limited to some degree in the amount of money that they can raise in their own behalf.
Buy time for commercials.
Exactly.
All those commercials you see
yeah,
during the
exactly.
evening news. And
So they have to get the lowest unit rate for those spots. So they're given a break under federal law, which was designed to give all the parties a relatively even break on that. However, the special interest groups, the outside people who are buying time in favor of a candidate or an issue or a position, they're not subject to that advantage. So the television and radio stations can charge anything they want, and they're charging maximum rates to all of them because they can. And it's mm-hmm. still a tough advertising market.
Do you think
that
will impact the number of ads we see on local airways this year?
It could to a degree, because every station is going to try to maximize the profit for every piece of advertising they sell. Every 30 or every 60-second unit, they want to get as much as they can out of it. Is the economy's still a little bit soft, and their normal commercial advertisers, while they're coming back to some degree, still haven't quite come all the way back yet. Okay. So they want to get as much money as they can. This can be a bonanza.
Might cut down on the number of commercials that the not the candidates, but the outside groups.
It could,
afford.
Or at very least, it'll make them more expensive. So they're going to have to carefully marshal their money more so than maybe they even anticipated, because they don't get that lowest unit rate break.
Thank you so much for coming in today. Interesting as always. Mm-hmm. Bob Smith, host of 1370 Connection on WXXI, voice of the voter 2012, and our Vote Up New York project are supported in part by the Community Foundation. Our media partners include the Democrat and Chronicle, 13 WHAM TV, and WDKX-FM. From now until November 6, we will bring you in-depth news and analysis about the issues that matter to voters like you.